Buenos días a todos y a todas. Queremos comprender el mundo. Es el lema que nos va a acompañar en estos dos días durante el Congreso y estaréis de acuerdo conmigo en que comprender el mundo significa también que todas las personas, independientemente de sus necesidades de apoyo, puedan acceder, puedan entender, puedan navegar y puedan interactuar en la web. En 2016, el 80% de los españoles habían utilizado Internet para diferentes cosas, para cosas tan cotidianas como buscar información, como hacer compras, como interactuar y relacionarnos con nuestros amigos y familiares, hacer gestiones bancarias, un larguísimo etcétera que hace que nuestra sociedad, nuestro día a día, nuestra cotidianidad sea cada vez más tecnológica. Es importante que esa cotidianidad más tecnológica no vaya unida con que sea una cotidianidad o un día a día más complejo, porque si fuera así, entonces sería poco accesible o nada accesible para un número importantísimo de personas. La accesibilidad web y, sobre todo, la accesibilidad cognitiva en desarrollos y diseños web es uno de los retos más importantes a los que nos enfrentamos. Lisa Simon, desde hace ya 20 años, lleva representando a personas con dificultades cognitivas, entre las que están personas con discapacidad intelectual o del desarrollo, y tratando de que la accesibilidad cognitiva se incorpore en todos los diseños y desarrollos webs. Lisa es una figura clave en la incorporación de la accesibilidad cognitiva en los criterios y pautas de accesibilidad web. Lisa actualmente es investigadora en accesibilidad en IBM y coordina el grupo de trabajo COGA, que es un grupo de trabajo sobre accesibilidad cognitiva en entornos webs de el W3C, que luego ella nos explicará mejor, pero es como una comunidad o un consorcio internacional que trata de desarrollar requisitos o pautas sobre cómo debe ser Internet, ¿no? Lisa, en definitiva, con su trabajo, con sus investigaciones, pues contribuye a que la tecnología sea más humana, sea más personalizada y, por lo tanto, sea más inclusiva. Creemos que es importante abrir este congreso con una conferencia con un tema tan relevante. Estamos seguras de que Lisa pondrá mucha luz sobre este tema, pero también estamos seguras que abrirá muchas preguntas que generarán mucha inquietud y mucho aprendizaje en los que estamos aquí. Así que, Lisa, thank you very much. Muchas gracias.
Is it working? Can you hear me? Okay. Sometimes I mumble, so if you can't hear me, then raise your hands in the back. We can practice. I can mumble, and then you can raise your hands. Okay. I'm sorry I'm speaking in English. My Spanish is not good enough. So I've been introduced, so I won't talk about myself too much. I chair a task force group. We run a group to look at how we can improve inclusion and accessibility for people with cognitive disabilities and learning disabilities on the web. And my slides have gone. So what we're going to talk to you a bit about today is accessibility, what that means on the web, and cognitive disabilities and how we're trying to move cognitive inclusion into web accessibility, which has been focused a lot on other disabilities. So what is web accessibility? Web accessibility is making the web pages, how to make web pages, usable for people with disabilities, all different types of disabilities, whether it's that they can't see, if they're blind, if they can't hear, if they can't use a mouse or a touchpad, but they have a switch, all different disabilities, including obviously cognitive and learning disabilities, need to be able to use the web. And it's becoming more and more important because the web and your smartphones, your phones, these are ways people communicate today and people do all kinds of important tasks. So if we want to include people in society, We need them to be able to use the web and the internet. Can you go to the next slide? The different types of disabilities, there are quite a few of them. There we go. The different types of disabilities that I've mentioned, for instance, people who can't see, they might be using, if they can't see the screen, they might be using something that reads the screen to them. It's called text-to-speech. So anything that's on any text on the screen will get read to them. And the different elements, the different things in a page also get read to the user. And they can then know when to click and when to press the button to get to the next stage, or to swipe. And they can know how to use a website, even though they can't actually see the website or they can't see the phone application. People are using all these different technologies, but when other people make the web page or the application, do they know how to make it in a way that these applications can use them? And that's where web accessibility comes into place. Web accessibility is about making some rules that everybody can follow when making a web page, so that it can be used by all different types of disabilities. The group that I'm part of here is the World Wide Web Consortium. I'm a private, I work for a private company, so there's a disclaimer. I don't represent them, I just work with them and do things for them. The World Wide Web Consortium is a group that make the rules for how you make web pages. All different types of web pages. They're languages people use, codes people use, like HTML, and these standards get set by an organization called the World Wide Web Consortium. It was founded by the inventor of the internet, Sir Tim Berners-Lee. And very fortunately, they have a group called the Web Accessibility Initiative. They have inside this group that makes the web standards, and they deal with accessibility. The main standard for web accessibility is called the Web Content Accessibility Guidelines. That's quite long. It's called WCAG for short. That's what it stands for. And these tell web authors, people making a web page, how they can write the page that it works with the different technologies used by people with disabilities. Now, laws often reference this work. So laws will often say, you need to conform, you need to follow these rules. The countries don't make the rules, that's made by the World Wide Web Consortium, but the laws sometimes say, you need to follow them. And that's the case in Europe and in Spain. The way this standard is made, it's divided into principles, which are like big ideas of what you should do. And then those are divided into smaller, more clear ideas of what you should do. And then we have something we call success criteria. That's exactly what you need to do to make sure you're following the standard. And then we have documents of techniques which show people how they can do it, with code examples which people can follow and copy. So an example for general web accessibility for people who are blind, is if you have an image, and here I have on the screen, I have a bird that's often used to mean Twitter, follow us on Twitter, you press this bird. And that's a symbol people use for Twitter. Inside the code, there's something that calls a image that lets the screen know that there's an image coming. And the World Wide Web Consortium standard HTML has a place you can put text that would be read by a screen reader instead of the image. so that the image would say Twitter, and then people who can't see the image can have it read to them and they know what to do. So they know they can click here if they want to go to your Twitter account. So that's an example of a technique people can use to make their content work with screen readers. But now we're talking about cognitive and people with learning disabilities. And what can we do to make the same page usable by people with more cognitive disabilities? There are many different types, and there are many different aspects that are that need to be thought about. People have short-term memory and different memory problems. There are many different types of memory. Some people can't remember what things look like very well. Some people can't hold lots of information in their memory at the same time. Different people have different issues when it comes to memory. Some people have problem with reading. Some people have trouble figuring things out, so it can take them a bit longer. So if you've got a, instead of buttons, you've got dots that people are meant to figure out, you press this dot and something happens. Not everyone's going to figure that out. Some people have trouble with keeping focused. They can get distracted easily, and then they can forget what they were doing. So if you have tasks with lots of steps in it, and you get distracted, and what have you done, and what haven't you done? And then there's some people who are very, very bad at numbers. Everything else could work completely fine. Just the area of their brain that figures out numbers doesn't work. But they also need to be included and accommodated. Sorry. Now, the numbers are huge. And if people are trying to convince your organization that it's worth working in this area on including more people, they should look at the numbers, because there are lots of people with a specific learning disabilities, like dyscalculia, who can't do numbers, dyslexia, who have trouble with reading, and obviously intellectual disabilities. There are people who are neurodiversity, they just think differently to the way the designer might think. A very important area, if you're convincing people on why they should be doing it, if they're a company and they're trying to make money, they need to sell to the aging. Europe, the world, is getting older. When people age, a lot of people have problems with memory, and they often have problems staying focused, and often it takes them longer to learn new things. This is not just people with dementia, but also people with dementia. Just often when people age, they find they learn new things slower. But there's huge numbers, and we need to include them. Another huge group is people when they are anxious or depressed, their skills go down. You can have trouble keeping focus. You can have trouble with your memory because you're panicking. And the last thing you want when you're panicking is that you can't make a doctor's appointment or you can't call for help, right? That would not be good. So on the one hand, we have huge numbers and an aging community. And on the other hand, we have more and more things that are done over your phone or on the web. Making a doctor's appointment. Now, if I can't make a doctor's appointment, I have to ask someone to help me. That means that the government have to pay for caregivers, just because of silly things that I would be able to do myself if it was done in a way I can do it. My father has dementia, he has Alzheimer's. We got a new TV screen for him. Early stage, he could more or less live at the home if someone pops in twice a day. The television came with three remote controls, three things to click to to turn it on and get the right channel and the right volume. So he couldn't do it anymore. If it would have just have had a button on off and a thing of the program which you turn and a thing of the volume which you turn, he could have carried on using his television set for a few more years. And even worse was the heating system. He was in an apartment with a new heat. They got new heating systems, which also had these remote control things. Instead of having an on-off button, it had some symbol that he didn't know. And even though he was quite good in terms of someone with dementia, he's not going to learn new symbols to turn on the heat. And it went between hot and cold air. Someone came in the middle of the day to visit him, turned on the cold air, and then left. And it got cold at night. And when my sister, thank God, popped by, and he was so cold, she had to take him to the emergency room. When you can't turn between hot and cold, then you need someone to live with you. And he didn't really need it. He just needed it because of these systems that we build without considering how we can include everybody. So it's really silly from everyone's perspective. If you're trying to make a heating system, you should make it that more customers can use it. If you're trying to have a government policy, you want to save money, right? Not tax people so you can have caregivers so that they can turn on the heating, when I could do it myself if it had been designed in a way I can use. So making the most of these, making these standards so people know what to do to include more people is really important. And if you're trying to convince your company to adopt them and to look at them, then looking at the aging, they actually have most of the savings and the money. A lot of young people, they owe money because of their university or they're just starting, whereas older people are much more likely to buy an expensive holiday and to travel. So including them, it makes sense as well as being just right. So that's why they started the Cognitive Accessibility Task Force. It's part of the World Wide Web Consortium, part of the group that makes the web standards on how we can include more people. So what we did, the first thing we did is research. We needed to find out what problems people have and what works for different people. When we've done all that research, we can see what's missing, what needs to be done, and then we can suggest things to the standards. We can suggest things beyond the standards, because the standards are often law, so you have to make it more reasonable what's being included so everyone can do it. And also, what technologies? How can we help new technologies so that more people can be included with new apps and new types of content? So the first stage is user research. There's so many different types of disabilities here. We try to take a mixture. So we took some very relatively small but wide things like dyslexia. Dyscalculia is when people can't do numbers. ADD, people who can't focus well. Nonverbal are people who have difficulty for lots of different reasons with talking, and that's becoming more important as there are these bots like Alexa, or where you speak and the car door becomes unlocked, right? You want that to work for everybody. Then we've got dementia and mild cognitive impairments that happen when people age, intellectual disabilities such as Down syndrome. That was the first set we looked at. We intend to look at more. We're doing it like going round in circles. So we'll look at some, and then we'll look at some more, and see if we've covered all the different issues. So these were the first ones we looked. They're very different, with different needs. Then we also looked at issues. Issues not just about one group, but they kind of go across all different kinds of content and people. One is logging in to a website or to an application. There's so many different ways to do it now. You could do it through recognizing the face. But when people only give you one way to log onto your content, it can be a problem because people often can't remember the password if they've got to do a long password and things like that. So that's an example of an issue, and in finding out what technologies we can do to solve this. Another is the phone systems. If you can't make your doctor's appointment on the website, can you call and make a doctor's appointment? And often the answer is no as well, because they've got these systems with complicated menus where it says, press 2 for internal services. And by the time I'm thinking, is my doctor's appointment an internal service? I've forgotten that I needed to press 2. So there are lots of things that can go wrong there. If you have a standard, 0 always takes you to an operator. Whenever you get to one of these complicated things, if you have a standard that all the government, all the health, all the important places are using, says press 0 and you'll get to a person, then you can have these systems, and if I get stuck, I'll be able to get help. But it needs to be in a standard. So we look at all these things and we see, okay, what's missing? And then we made a gap analysis where we pull together from all the different disabilities, and all the different issues. We try to think, what does the user need? And the user needs to be able to log into the site. The user needs to know where they are. The user needs to be able to fill in the form, and it's not too complicated, and you don't make it in a way that more people are going to make mistakes. You don't accept their phone number if it has dashes in, or you make it more complicated sometimes, and then less people can use it. There are lots of different user needs that we went through and try to identify, and then based on that we can identify what the solutions are. And one that I think is very well understood here, but not in the broader world, is people need to understand the content. They need to understand the text. So are you using clear and simple words? Often when people have a core, when people could only learn 500 words, they're given a core vocabulary. They're taught the 500 most common words. So if you use that in your website, more people will understand it. And also some people know symbols. So if you're using symbols, all these things are good advice to meet the user need. And then we suggested them to WCAG what to do. We made 39 suggestions. Most of them did not get in. So we pulled in these techniques. Some places are using this. This is a Horizon 2020 EU project. They took this health application, and using some of these techniques, they changed it to make it more usable. You can see on the right, you've got less options, and there's symbols, and easier words, less going on to confuse people. And it's the same application. When we suggested it to the web, the next draft of the web standards, most didn't go in, some did. The login one is a very important one, so that did get in. And also a few on personalization, 2 on personalization got in at different levels. Personalization helps. Personalization, it's about putting in the code of the page what the thing is, and then it can be adapted to what's familiar to you, what you know. So let's say you have a save button. Some people know this icon, this picture, symbol. It's of a floppy disk, which people don't have anymore. So some people, that's what they've grown up with and they know. Some people know the word save, and some people might know a different symbol that means something to them for saving. So if you know what the thing is, you can make a application that sits on the phone or on your browser, on your computer, that would put the picture or the word that you know next to this important control. So that's one that did get in. And that also encourages more technology. So here's another example we've got of complicated application for writing documents. It's got all kinds of features, but there's some very basic ones. Open, close, scroll up and down so you can read the document. If you've put in the code that these are the crucial features, then you could have a toolbar at the bottom for some users who want less features, and it makes it simpler. But even what that toolbar looks could be good for that user. So you could have some people who find words, they're good with words, especially people with dementia, actually simple words are often the best option. But other people have symbols for the same thing. So they might have open and close, and they just want the symbols and they don't want the words. And it can map to the symbols they personally know, that they personally learned. So we've also made another group inside the World Wide Web Consortium that's making the codes. And if anyone's interested in being involved in that project as well, so that programmers can put these codes into their page and make it more accessible. Because not all of the ideas that we have and that we know helps can go into a standard for everybody by law, we're going to make another document also, and it should be up in about a month, where we're pulling together all the advice that we have that shouldn't be necessarily law. So we would like it if people reviewed that. And that includes things like user needs, testing with real people. You can't expect everyone to be able to afford testing, but we'll hope to be able that critical services like the water, your doctor's appointment, the government, they should test, right? So how do you test with people with learning and cognitive disabilities? So we're going to do all this, and then we're going to go back to the beginning and look at more groups and more issues and see what we can do. Also, the next groups are going to include some of the emotional disabilities. If people are depressed or if they're stressed, and then your skills go down and how that gets affected. So that will be the next phase through this process. Now, you may want to get involved. There's two ways that come to mind. Firstly, I would ask as many people here to comment on the draft of the Web Standard Work Ag. I have here a link to the latest draft. It's not finished yet. And some people will say, oh, we don't want to do that. I know we're going to get comments saying this is too hard for us to do. So we need people to comment and say this is important as well. And also, if they are, I've got the link to all the 39 issues that we wanted to put in. And if people can think what's the most important for them and also comment on that, that will make them be more likely, it will make the, help the group know what to focus on. And it's a long process getting them in. So if people want to review that and help us know what to focus on, that's also very helpful. And also, we are happy to have more people joining this task force, looking at the issues, identifying the user needs, and telling us what we missed altogether, not just what we couldn't get in, but what we forgot about, what we didn't know There's a lot of experts in this room who understand users, and we'd be happy to have more feedback from there as well. That's it. Thank you. And thank you, obviously, to this wonderful organization, Plan Our Inclusion, who have put this together. It's very, very impressed, and thank you for inviting me.
Os iba a hablar en inglés. Desgraciadamente no hay tiempo para hacer preguntas, pero Lisa va a estar con nosotros los dos días, o sea que en cualquier momento de descanso, de comida, de cena, de ruta turística, pues podréis preguntarle y hablar con ella. Muchísimas gracias, Lisa, por tu conferencia y sobre todo por esa invitación que nos hace a participar y contribuir en todas las investigaciones, ¿no?, y las líneas de trabajo que están haciendo. Muchísimas gracias.